So good morning one and all.
Good morning.
On behalf of Rajarambapu College of Pharmacy Kasegaon and organizing committee of this national level webinar series, I welcome you all on this second day of this session. Yesterday Dr. G.D. Gupta sir has guided us on e-learning in pharmaceutical sciences in very lucid language. Now today we are fortunate enough to have one more speaker, eminent personality in patenting, Dr. Amrish Chandra sir. Now I would like to request Dr. V.R. Salunke sir to introduce Dr. Amrish Chandra sir. Salunke sir, please.
On behalf of Kasegaon Education Society and Rajaram Bapu College of Pharmacy, with respect to our fellow principal Dr. C.S. Magdum sir, vice principal Dr. S.K. Mohite sir, and the coordinator Dr. Manoj Nitrika sir, who have given me chance to present this biographic module of eminent personality in India, Dr. Amrish Chandra. Dr. Amrish Chandra is an established academician, a research scientist working with MIT University Delhi, NCR, for approximately a decade, and obtained B.Pharm from one of the best institute under Amaravati University, Maharashtra in the year 2000. He obtained his M.Pharm degree in pharmaceutical biotechnology from Birla Institute of Technology, Mesra, Ranchi, Jharkhand in 2002. He qualified GATE with 92.32 percentile. He started his career from Uttar Pradesh Technical University in 2002. He got his PhD from Udalkhand University, State Government University. He was rewarded Indo-Hungary European Research Project by International Division of Department of Science and Technology, Government of India. Dr. Chandra has served in various administrative and academician positions for more than 17 years at various institutes, UP Technical University and other universities. He was head of the pharmacy at Meghalaya University, Aligarh. He has supervised and 8 PhD, 25 M.Pharm thesis, and published more than 75 research papers in international and national journals with cumulative impact point of more than 54, H index of 11, I-10 index of 14, and citation of above 60-90. He has been investigator of research project funded by various government agencies and pharmaceutical industry for more than 1.75 crore. Dr. Chandra has filed patents for his tall inventions. He has published 5 books, book chapters. He has been the invited speaker at national and international university in Europe, like the University of Szeged, Hungary. He has also filed 11 patents to his credit. He is a registered patent agent with the Government of India. He has a vast array of experience with all aspects of the patent process and wants to play his role in building national innovation capability by making patent filing affordable to the large community of students through Lexin, your partners of Innovation India. He is supported in his endeavor by White Science Innovation Limited UK, for which he has an advisory board member. He has superheads Big Innovation Drive, which award up to 1 lakh rupees for the best innovation in the domain. He also serves as an advisory capacity in many institutions and universities. He is a dedicated philanthropist too, and along with his better half, Dr. Seema Garg, faculty and researcher in chemistry work for the orphan children through Navaya Welfare Society, named on the name of his their daughter. His administrative experience include PCI approval of new institutes and continuing approval, construction of animal house, and IAEC approval. Served as a head university proctor, examination superintendent, member of board of study, departmental research committee, hostel management committee, convocation committee, anti-ragging committee, anti-narcotic committee, quality assurance, and enhanced. Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank
with
you.
This best
thank you, Dr. Vijay, thank you very much for and very, very elaborate introduction.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you. Now, I would like to request to proceed, Dr. Nitrikar, sir.
We will request him to start his session.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so I start my session now?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. So welcome all the participants. It's a very good morning. So I am currently in Agra and it's raining a little bit. So feeling the good rain over here. It's a pleasant weather outside. And so today we'll be talking on a topic which is called as Building Innovation and IPR Protection. Okay. So this is my university campus where I work. It's MIT University, spread over 60 acres and plus 20 more acres that we acquired recently. So 80 acres with 40,000 students and 4,000 faculty members over here. So it's a big university and we have a plethora of courses over here. I have two main collaborations. One I have with Hungary, okay, and the other one I have with Italy. So this is a little team that we see over here when I went to Hungary. And on the side, you have my Italian partner who is working on a project with me. So my passion, if I talk, it's I'm passionate about improving the academic output and showcasing the research findings of academicians and bringing their research to the forefront for the benefit of the society. So what we mostly see is faculty members are more inclined towards publishing their work. So they do a lot of work, they do a lot of research work and everything. And the education system and the promotion system in the country is built in such a way that it encourages more of publication and less of patenting. So the moment a professor has got something good to show the world, he would go for a publication. And even if there are PhD students or PG students, they want to complete their degree. And so they will first go for publication and they will not go for patenting. So this is my passion that I am helping. I can help the community to bring up their innovations as in the form of patents to the world. So going back to the century 320 to 550 century, the Gupta dynasty. So there we had these two very famous books, Charak Sanhita and Shishrata Sanhita. So we all know that these books contain a lot of medicines and everything. And sir, I told you in the beginning, there's some feature called as annotation is active and we will be having constant trouble throughout the presentation. As you can see, some people putting scratch marks and everything. So that needs to, you need to go into the settings and change that the people can't do annotate. So we have these two books, Charak Sanhita and Shishrata Sanhita, where we have one of the book deals with the medicine and the other one deals with surgery. So we had all this great knowledge and everything. Ayurveda was very strong and we could treat most of the things. But down the line, when we went, we came under British rule and then British systems came into the country. Somehow or the other, we forgot all these things and everything got lost on the way. So instead of treating the entire disease and everything, we came into a picture where we could, now we are doing symptomatic treatment. We don't do the whole body treatment. We just do symptomatic treatment. Okay. And because of the symptomatic treatment and all everything, what came up in our society was more of allopathic medicines, where when you have fever, you give them paracetamol. If you have vomiting, you give them some other drug. So this is how the things work. But when you talk of intellectual property, so why is it important that we have this intellectual property with us? So way back when we were nomads and everything, we just had a few equipments or things with us. There was used to be a closed group and everything used to be kept in a closed group. So the people guarded those things. So if you had weapons, if you had wheel, if you could make fire. So all these things were guarded by a small number of people over there. When things went up and you had industrial revolution, then you had these big factories spanning about acres of land. They had very much high operational excellence. So when you say operational excellence, it means ki in a factory, they could make, suppose there was a person who could make 100 cars in a day. So by elaborating everything, making good assembly lines and everything, they could make 1,000 cars in a day. Now, again, having this kind of a setup, so big financial investment and everything, it became difficult for someone else to copy such kind of inventions. So they also did not need to fear more much about intellectual property and all. But as time went by, more and more people had a lot of funds. So money was not a problem. So they could make such big factories and everything. But the problem was that what about people who have got the idea? Who generate something from their brain. Currently, you see there are many softwares, there are many things, there are many chemical reactions or something, which can be developed by sheer thinking. We don't need to like have such a big factory or something to come up with the research and everything. Just the idea can turn wonders. And when you talk of innovation, basically, whatever research that you do, okay, and all the industries that you see, be it pharma industry, be it chemicals, be it paints industry, be it automobile, mobiles, whatever it is, all the industries are very much research intensive. So if you don't do research in any particular field, the industry will just get wiped out. The company, the entire brand is going to move out of the picture if you don't do research, if you're not research intensive. That is the first thing. And research, as you see, it's not free of cost. It requires a lot of money over there. Okay. So for this high cost, what you need to do is there's a lot of cost involved in it. This cost needs to be recovered. So if you're not able to recover the cost, how will you do the research? And when it comes to pharmaceutical sector especially, the difference between the basic research and the applied research is very small. The gap is very, very small. So suppose if you are working in a lab and you are trying to improve the solubility of a particular product. So you increase the solubility of, say, curcumin or say any other drug. Yeah. Now, on a very upper scale, it would look like a very basic research. Okay, it's fine. It cannot be converted into a product or something. But as you go down the line, what you will be able to do, some other company may read your article. And after reading your article, they may make a injectable or a solution out of it or a syrup kind of a thing out of your work that you have done. That's the third thing. Further, when you when your youngsters, young faculty members or students, if they want to start their own companies, so for the small and medium scale enterprises, even if you have just one good patent with you, you will be able to start the industry. So the entire industry, the whole company can be established on the basis of one good patent. That is the fourth thing. And even if you don't want to go and start a company, you don't want to get into the trouble of marketing and everything. And if you have an intellectual property right, if you have a patent, you can just go and sell that patent to someone and get money out of it. So you don't, if you are not capable, if you don't want to start your own company, just have an idea, get it patented, work on it, and sell your patent to the person who is interested in it. Now I'll give you a very famous example of this particular thing. Okay. And this basically is so there was a very famous company called as Eli Lilly, and there was a molecule called as cefaclor. Okay. So what basically happened with cefaclor was that in India, way back in 1970s, we did not have something which is called as a product patent. So giving you just an idea of how the old patent act was. So there are two things basically. One is called as a product patent and the other one is a process patent. So suppose if you patent paracetamol molecule, okay, or a paracetamol tablet, no, paracetamol, that will be called as a product. So paracetamol is a product and that is called as product patent. However, the method of making paracetamol, say combining A plus B plus C will give you D, okay, or paracetamol. So that is called as a process. So way back in 1970s, we did not have the process product patent. We just had the process patent in India. Now, because of this process patent, what happened when Eli Lilly came into India, with this molecule cefaclor, what they did basically was that they tried to make all this particular molecule through all possible mechanisms by which they could make. So their scientists, they had good scientists, highly paid scientists, well-established labs and equipments and everything. They worked hard day and night, and they came up with 32 methods or processes by which this molecule cefaclor could be made. Now, after making these 32 processes, they thought that there's no other process by which we can make this particular thing. So now let's go and patent all these 32 processes in India. And when we sell this cefaclor into India, there will be no one else will be able to make cefaclor because we have worked out all the possible methods that are possible for making this particular molecule. So they came to India, and when they came to India, see, Indian brains are very sharp. There's no doubt about it. They are the most rewarded brains across the globe. Even if you go to foreign countries, people would like to have students from India for the in their research labs just because of their brain power. So we in 1917, and Baxi company, okay, so this company particularly, what they did, they found out the 33rd way of doing the of synthesizing cefaclor. So though Eli Lilly had all these patents, 32 patents for this particular molecule, still Ranbaxy could find a 33rd way of making this particular cefaclor, and they could get a patent on it, and Eli Lilly company could not do anything. Okay. So that is how the patent basically worked. And because of this particular thing, you see just one patent, getting one patent out of it, though this particular step which happened in India, it established India throughout the world as a intellectual capital. So earlier people used to think that India has only got laborers, they can work hard, they are cheap and everything, they don't have intellectual knowledge. But after this, India got established as a intellectual power also in the pharma sector. Now I'll give you this picture. Just have a very, very careful look at it. This is the list where we have regions, patent granted and patent received in 2017. So globally, you see 1.4 million or 14 lakh patents were filed. Okay. Out of these patents, 4 lakh 20,000 was by China, 3 lakh 18,000 something was by US. And India patent granted was just 12,387. Okay, so you can see the vast difference that we exist in the number of patent granted and in China, US and India. Okay, now it was not that India is very strict and that we grant very few patents and other countries are very liberal. They grant a lot of patents to them. And if you see the number of applications that you received from this thing, okay. So China, you see, they received 1.38 million patents. US received 6 lakh patents, out of which 3 lakh were granted. In India, 46,000 patents were received, out of which 12,000 was granted. So still not a very pleasing picture. Now to make things even more complicated and more troubling, the data is that entities and individuals based in India filed just 1,712 patents. So inventors like you and me, a university, a company in India, you know, which is registered in India. So these companies, they filed 1,712 patents. And rest of the 10,675 patents came from abroad. So for example, a company in US, Germany, Japan, they have filed a patent. They have got a patent for themselves, okay, for their company. And now they want to come and sell their product in India. So they need to come and file a patent in India also. Because you see, there is nothing called as world patent, global patent, or as international patent, basically. So what we basically say is that patent is a territorial right. So if you want to sell your product in India, you need to have a patent in India. If you want to sell it in Germany, you might need a patent in Germany. So wherever you have a patent, you have the right to prevent others from making your invention. So that is how it works. The good thing, however, is that the share of pharmaceutical industry out of these patents is 15.7%. And when it comes to designs and trademarks, still we are comparatively better as compared to other countries. Now, let me know in your chat boxes. The chat boxes are very much open. Can you let me know who this gentleman is? Can you just type in the chat box who this celebrity is? And which movie does it belong to? What is the movie? The movie? You can just type it in the chat box. Yes, Anuradha. So it's Three Idiots, and the movie is Aamir Khan, Shankar, Dr. Raut. Thank you. So it's right. It's Aamir Khan and the movie is Three Idiots. Very much right. And whom did he work upon? So he's the person whom he probably tries to copy or tends to copy or tries to portray a person who is called as Sonam Wangchuk. Okay. Now Sonam Wangchuk is a person. The real name is Sonam Wangchuk. In the movie, it was Fungsuk Wangru. Very much right, Sandeep. So he was born in 1996 and he made some good contribution to the world, to the Ladakh. So he stays in Ladakh, basically. He's founder of a school which is called a SEMCOL. And basically what happened when you study English medium or NCERT books or CBSE medium or something. Okay. So what we see that basically these books are more designed towards the local Indian population suppose if you're studying green trees and you're studying about green crops, cows, buffaloes, and all those things, and camels and everything in normal books. But when the same subject and the same thing was taught to the students in Ladakh, they could not comprehend, they could not visualize how a cow or a buffalo would look like, how would a camel look like, okay? Because Ladakh, you see, it's a cold desert and there is nothing of that sort. You just have sheep and oxes and other things. So they were very much confused about it. So he developed his own curriculum kind of a thing where he gave local examples, picked up local stories, and then he gave education. So that was more relevant to the people. And then he made a technique which is called a siphon technique, just like the rivers flood, lakes also flood. So he said that if you can just siphon out by using gravity principle, the way we siphon out water by using a small pipe. So he did that and he saved it. And again, he gave a very good idea of ice stupa. So what happened basically, ice stupa, as you see, Ladakh is a cold desert. So you have water flowing from the stream in the months of October, November. But when winters come in December, January, February, March, April, so this particular season from December to March, April, you don't have water because ice over the glaciers has frozen and there's no water flowing down. Okay. So what he did during the month of October, November, when there was still water in the rivers, he brought that water down from a pipe and he sprayed the water in the form of a siphon, in the form of a fountain. So as the water went up and it fell down, it formed a ice stupa or a conical structure. So now this conical structure basically has an advantage that if you study geometry, you will come to know that cone is the only geometric structure in for which the light exposure at a certain time is just 1/3. Okay, so only 1/3 of this cone, ice stupa, which is in a conical structure, gets exposed to the sun at any time of the day. So ice would slowly melt in the month of February, March as the sun came out, and this water would be used for irrigation. So that is what it did. And in the example, I would give you, like, you must have seen this particular thing. And as you can see, it used to get stuck to our pants, to our sweaters and everything. And it's very difficult to remove them. They just get stuck and they damage the clothes and everything. So there was a scientist, who Swiss inventor, whose name was Georges de Mestral. So he studied this particular thing for a large number of years. And then he developed something which is called as nylon. So he saw that nylon fibers, when they're treated with laser, they turn into hard hooks. Okay. And these hard hooks can be used in the form of Velcro. So you're very much aware of this particular thing. It's called as a Velcro. And this particular thing is used in blood pressure monitor, shoes laces, curtains, clothes, and everything. So this is how it works. So basically, my principle of telling you, my idea of telling you all these two stories about Sona Wangchuk and this George D. Mestral story about Velcro is that ideation is for everyone. It is not that you need to be a PhD or a postdoc or everything to be able to ideate. Yes, having a PhD, a postdoc, gives you a lot of lab skills and everything by which you can work and you can strive hard. Okay, so that is true. But otherwise, problem solving can be done by anyone. You don't need to be a master of something. Okay, so ideation is a personal problem solving approach of a non-routine kind. So we all have problem in our daily lives. The only thing is that we need to be a little more sensitive to the problem, and we should be looking for problem in every walk of our life. Problem, we can solve it. So for someone like sitting down and tying a shoelace might not be a big problem, okay? But someone else might see that it is a problem because, see, I'm getting late to the office and I have to see it. My shoelace are not tied and I need to sit down and tie a shoelace. Or when I go around, sometimes the shoelace is open, okay? So for someone, it may not be a problem, but for some other person, it might be a problem. And therefore, the shoes without shoelace were invented and they came into being and people started using it. So this is how we become more sensitive to the problem and we start solving them. Okay. Now we'll take an example of this particular thing, alarm clock. Now the first thing that you do, everyone does in the morning, is that they wake up. Okay. This is very true. You don't do anything before you wake up. And this particular device is very much used for waking you up. Okay. So can I have some answers from the audience in the chat box? whether is this alarm clock a very good invention, or this alarm clock is foolproof and there's no need to invent anything more. This is a perfect example and it does the work very nicely. You put the alarm clock and you can just wake up anytime in the morning. So do you think it is a perfect thing or it needs improvement? Some answers from in the chat box from the audience, please. Just yes or no. Is it fully foolproof invention or it needs improvement? Okay. So basically, yes, you see that this kind of alarm clock and other things. So when you use this alarm clock, there's a problem that you need to set it daily in the night. You need to switch it on. So sometimes if you forget to switch this particular thing on, it will not beep the next morning, because in the morning you have closed it and it does not have an automatic function to beep the next morning. So then came digital clocks. So there was an advantage that you could see the time at night also. This alarm used to be recurring, that you don't need to set it and you don't need to switch it every day. You just alarm beeps, you close it now, you wake up, and next morning also you don't need to do anything. It will automatically beep. So a recurring alarm. But again, there was a problem that people used to snooze this alarm. They used to go back to the bed, go and sleep. And they used to get late for their office, their schools, or any other things. So, yeah, they miss their trains and flights and everything. So further development is still needed in this particular thing. So what happened? There was one gentleman, what he did, he made something called as walking or revolving clock. So what you do basically, I do see answers that mobile phone have taken the place of alarm clocks right now. Yes, again, my mobile clocks also have the same problem. They have a good option that you can set any music as an alarm. That is a good advantage that you have. You can change that music whenever you want, which is not very much possible in the digital clocks. But again, the problem of snooze is always there in mobile clocks also. Okay. Now, there's a gentleman who came up with this idea. And as you can see, the clock has wheels. So you set the alarm and you keep it on the floor besides your bed. And when you wake up in the morning, the clock will not be there. You will have to hunt for the clock where it is. It is under the bed or somewhere roaming around in the room. You have to switch on the light, get down from the bed, search for the clock, catch it, and then close it. Okay. So I think that would be sufficient to wake you up still. But still, if it does not meet your needs, there was another person who said that, okay, why walk? Why not the alarm clock flies? So he made an alarm clock with a helicopter or drone kind of a thing. So the moment alarm beeps, the clock flies up and you need to go get on the top of the bed and catch the alarm clock and snooze it off. So basic example, basic intention for showing you this is not to make you ask you to make another alarm clock, but it is basically to tell that there is no end to improvement. There's no end to innovating. There's no end to solving more and more problems as you go down the line. Next thing that you do after you wake up is you brush your teeth. Okay. Now, is this a foolproof invention? I would say no. So how does it improve? So you have electric brush. It could be chargeable or a battery one. So you just take the brush, put it in your mouth, switch on the phone. It will automatically vibrate and take out all the food and debris that you have in your teeth. If that is still not sufficient, there's an invention, good invention. Probably, I think some pharmacy student must have done it some time back. So he combined, someone combined a syringe and a toothbrush together. So you can see that syringe has got a paste filled in it, and then there is the bristles. So you rotate the particular thing from the bottom and a small quantity of paste would come out on the bristles. So when you go for traveling or anytime, you don't need to press that toothpaste very hard to take it out. Or when you go for a travel, you just carry one toothbrush with you. So it will work in both the ways, as a brush also and as a toothpaste also. So you don't need to carry a lot. And still, if you think that this is not enough, someone invented something like this. So you just take the particular thing, place it among your teeth, okay, and press the button. And both the teeth, the top and the bottom, the entire jaw, both the jaws would be cleaned in a few seconds. So again, you see, there's no limit to inventions. You just need to go thinking more and more and more in order to be able to design new things. The next thing that you do in the morning is you go for a bath. Okay. So bathing was usually by the bucket and the mug. But as the inventions came up, we got showers, and then people were not satisfied with the shower. They wanted light, and then they wanted song, and then they wanted more of water. But then someone must have felt a need that once when I went to this particular place, somewhere where there was a waterfall, I enjoyed that waterfall a lot. It was very exciting to bath under a waterfall. So then again, an invention came up where you see on the first figure over here, the metallic shower bath. It has got a fountain kind of a flow also in the shower. It has got this hose also, but it has also got an option for shower in the form of a fountain. Okay, so you can enjoy bathing under a waterfall in the comfort of your home. So all these are inventions. These are design patents or inventions which you can always make things. Washing clothes, again, you see it's a very common thing. It was a traditional method. Then came semi-automatic washing machines. Again, it was not foolproof because you needed to hear it very carefully. Then take out the clothes from one portion and put it in the other spinning one and then do it. So it was a pain. People were very happy with when this particular thing came. Like ladies just said that it was life-saving. They could save a lot of time and energy and everything. But again, you see the inventions don't stop. So then came washing machines, fully automatic washing machines, where you could just put the clothes and it would wash also and it would spin also. Again, there was a problem that you can wash and spin, but what about drying? You still need to take out the clothes and go to the roof and put them on the balcony somewhere to get them dried and then collect them back. So again, then an invention came where the washing machine came fitted with a dryer. So you could wash, you could spin, and then a hot air would come out. Just like it comes out in a tablet coating pan. So similarly, in that way, the air would hot air would come inside it and it would dry the clothes also. Further innovations came, and now you are able to operate these washing machines from your office before you sleep, after you sleep, anytime, anywhere. So if you want, say you are reaching home by 5 o'clock and you want that the clothes should be washed, dried and everything. So you just set the timer, the washing machine will operate automatically. And by the time you come home, the clothes would be washed and everything. The next thing you do, so you get up, you by using an alarm clock and all those things. And then after you brushing your teeth, washing your clothes, you go for cooking. Now this is the conventional way of cooking, but if you just are able to see this particular thing, I will show you this video. So you can see this is a rotomatic kind of a thing. So you put your water over there and the floor. So you set the thickness and the softness of the roti and how much rotis you want, you set that. And just start it. So you can see the dough being prepared. So you see this is prepared and so all the while your wife or your sister or mother, they would do their own work, the rotis would be ready for them to come and eat. So just the way a CD comes out from the CD player, you will be having these rotis coming out. And then some people would think that cleaning is difficult. So again, they are showing that yes, cleaning is not very difficult in this. It's very easy to clean it. So So going down further, again, you see these are the keys. When you go to the office, then some remote keys came up, and then keyless keys came up, where you don't need to like really put the key into it. You just have a remote, and it will the car will automatically sense that you are the owner of this key. And if you have this key even in your pocket, the car will start. And then came keys which you can use in your mobile phone. And then there are keys with the LCD display on it, where you can see the level of engine and other things right on the screen of the remote. Okay. And these things can be like used and converted into a very thing, simple thing like that you see in your classes. So for example, you have been doing titrations very often. And when you do these titrations, you see that it's very difficult to judge the change in color. So light pink for someone would be a little darker, and for someone it would be a little less. So by using a simple technique, which is called as UV visible detector or a visible detector, you can convert it into an automatic system. So auto titrator is nothing, but it just has got a light source on one end and a detector on the other end. And when the light passes from this color from the solution, and the moment the color of the solution changes, the detector detects that there's a change in the color. And depending on the sensitivity and everything, the auto titration would stop. So that is how it works. Similarly, this is the conventional heating technique that we see. And sometimes we need to heat for 2 hours, 6 hours, 3 days, 5 days, 7 days. So all this can be saved by just using a microwave. So you can just use a microwave. So instead of heating for long, long, many hours, the same thing can be done in a few hours. So these are the comparatively things where you use your general knowledge that you have, the common sense that you have, and the problems that you see in the society, in your daily life, in your lab, and how you try to solve it. It's all thing. See, all the solutions will not come at your end. You will not be the single person who will be able to do it, but you will, by making a group of people, you will be able to really do it. Again, microscopes, these are common ones. Okay, then innovation came a little bit, and now you have more innovations. So you have a LED panel, and you can even many people, many different people sitting in different countries might be able to watch the same slide that you are watching. So if you have many collaborators in different countries, so all of the collaborators will be able to watch your slides by sitting at their respective places. Okay. So again, let me just tell you that ideation is a problem solving process. You just need to be more sensitive, okay, to the problems that you see. Now coming to the patent part, what is innovation? So when you talk of innovation, basically it has got three criteria: novelty, non-obviousness, and industrial applicability. Okay. So novelty means uniqueness. So it just means that whatever you are doing is completely unique. There is not even a single step that you are doing is common with someone else. So that is called as novelty. Okay. Then there's something which is called as non-obviousness. That means that the steps that you are using, they are not obvious to any person skilled in the art. So any person who is skilled in the art. Now this is a term which is used in patent law, and it has not been defined in the patent law what it actually means. So basically, a person skilled in the art means any person who has got all the knowledge, all the information of all the patents and all the non-patent literature, that is journals, books, and everything that is published till date. Yeah. So this particular hypothetical person has got the full knowledge of everything. Literature, okay. And then applicability means it has got industrial application. Now there are different types of patent applications. One is provisional application, and other one we'll call it as ordinary application or complete application. Okay. So if you are in ideation phase, your idea is not still fully mature, you are still working on it, but you think that someone else might steal your idea, or someone else is also working on a similar thing, and he might go and publish it, or he might go and patent it. So in that particular case, you go and file a provisional patent. So after filing a provisional patent, you get a time period of 12 months to complete the application. The complete application, technically it is known as ordinary application. Okay, so this is what we file. Okay, and then convention application is that when you file it in some country and then you file it in India, it is called as convention country application. PCT international application, when you file from India to outside India, it is called as international application. And when you say PCT national phase, it means from outside to inside. Now, what happens most of the time, researchers have a very fixed domain. They don't work in many different kind of domains. Okay, so a particular scientist might be working on transdermal or solubility or synthesis of a particular thing. So if you have filed a patent before and you think that this is an add-on work to what I have already filed, okay, you can go and file something which is called as patent of addition. So in this particular case, you will not need to pay the government fees again and again, and it would just be an easy thing to do. However, sometimes a patent application is basically given for a single invention, one patent for one invention. And suppose if you want to add two or three things into a single application, which are not related to each other, okay? So then the patent office will tell you to please divide this application into two or three applications, okay? So that is the kind of order that the patent office may give you. So new means, which is not published in India or elsewhere, this in prior public knowledge, and it's not been claimed in any specifications. So new basically means that if you say that my invention is new, okay, what does it mean? It basically means that it should not have been published anywhere, okay? And people should not be knowing about it. That is what is called as new. Inventive step means your invention has provided or given some technical advancement. Your invention has led to some technical advancement in it, you know, of the existing knowledge, or it has given some economic value, or it is not obvious to a person skilled in the art. So there are three things. Okay. So either you should have a technical advance or economic significance or both. And in addition to that, your invention should not be obvious to a person skilled in the art. So these are the main criteria. Industrial application basically means that it should be able to be made or used in any kind of industry. So if you are making some herbal composition or some drugs or something, so they should be able to, you should be able to use them in any industry, okay, or in any field. So industrial application, most of the work has got industrial applications. Now there are certain things, there are two things which what we can say basically. One is what can be patented and what cannot be patented. Now for any law to define what can be patented is very difficult, because that is intellectual creativity. You can think of A, B, C, anything you can think of. So what the patent law has done is they have defined what cannot be patented. Okay. So section 3 and 4 tell you what all cannot be patented. Okay. So any machine that gives you 100% performance. So you say that I have made a machine. If you put 100 grams of raw material, you will get 100 grams of product. Or if you put this much of this thing, you will get this much of energy output. Okay, so you know that by law, this is not possible, because there is certain friction, there is wear and tear, there are other losses in energy. So you cannot have a machine which gives 100% performance. So such patents which are frivolous or which are contrary to the natural laws cannot be patented. Again, machines like which destroy the public, which are not useful for the public. For example, gambling machine, devices for housebreaking, biological warfare things. Okay, so these things are not, again, they're not patentable, because they are contrary to public order and they cause prejudice to human, animal or plant health. So anything which is destroying the public, not useful for the public, cannot be patented. Okay. However, GMOs, especially microorganisms, can be patented. Okay. So you cannot patent any GMO which is related to plant or animal, but you can patent genetically modified organisms. Again, things like laws, okay, or discovery of a microorganism. So if you dig up soil or somewhere or some air you tap and you find out a new microorganism which is existing in the nature, or you develop a new law like Newton's law, you know. So these laws, you see, they have wide applicability, and there are a lot of applications which are based on these laws. So as such, if the office starts granting a patent to these kind of laws, then it would be very difficult for other people to work on it. Okay. And similarly, something which is already existing in the nature and you simply discover it. So if you discover a new planet or a new element, it cannot be patented, because it was already existing over there. And this thing is nature's gift. So it was not your intellectual property. So you will not get a patent on it. So the mere discovery of a scientific principle is not patentable. However, naturally organisms cannot be patented, but genetically modified organisms can be patented. Again, now suppose someone had a particular compound and you make a salt, it's ether or a polymorph or isomer of it, and you say that, okay, I'm going to patent this thing. Or if you say that this is neem, tulsi, adrak, or whatever it is, or ginger, and I know a new use for it and I want to patent it. Again, the government says that any new form, any new property or a new use cannot be patented. Because it is obvious that if a particular, say, chlorine salt will work, a potassium salt will work, if a hydrochloride salt will work, a sulfate salt will also work. So under these conditions, you will not get a patent for this particular thing unless you are able to prove that the efficacy is much higher. Some fixed dose combination, mixtures of neem, tulsi, ginger, and honey. So if you are making combinations like this, if it is a mere combination or a mere admixture, you will not get a patent of it unless it shows higher efficacy in terms of synergism. And again, this is for mixing chemical compounds. And similarly, if you mix two or three mechanical equipments or equipments together, like if, a bucket and a torch, they exist separately. But if you put a bucket and a torch together or umbrella and a fan together, you will not be able to get a patent on it. Yeah. So mere arrangement or rearrangement of a device is not patentable. Again, India is a very agriculture intensive country. Okay, so therefore method of agriculture is not patentable. So cultivation of algae, producing new form of a known plant, so these things are not patentable. Okay, so you cannot patent method of agriculture. Okay, however, if you make a new device or a new tractor or a new add-on to a tractor which can help you plow the field very smoothly and at a faster rate, those things can be patented. Again, medicines and treatment are very important for humanity. So if there is any method for surgery or any method of treatment, again, these methods are not patentable. So any process or a method, surgical, curative, prophylactic, or any treatment of human or animals is not patentable. Now, my pharmacy friends or friends in healthcare industry, they would think that, oh my God, I have made this particular medicine for treatment of diabetes or something, but I will not be able to patent it because treatment is not allowed. Okay. Now the patent law does not restrict you to a large extent, but they say that you cannot use the word treatment basically. However, if you say that my formulation or my composition can lower the insulin level in the blood, yes, you can go and patent that. But if you say that my particular formulation is going to treat diabetes, no, the patent office will say no, you cannot patent it. So that is where you need to have knowledge of what can be patented and what cannot be patented. Section 3, again, clones of new varieties of plants and biological processes, these cannot be patented. Okay. Any mathematical formula, method of doing a business or a computer program, these cannot be patented. But if a computer program is accompanied by hardware, you can patent it. But as such, mathematical and business models cannot be patented. What about a poem, a song, or a drawing, sculpture, or a movie? Okay, these things, as you know, they are very much covered under Copyright Act. And they are literally creations and artistic works. So these things are not covered under patent. They are covered under Copyright Act. Method of playing a game, chess, or solving rubric, or method of teaching. So even if an excellent professor or a faculty member develops a very good method of teaching, he will not be able to patent the method of teaching. Okay. So mere scheme or rule or method of performing a mental act or playing a game cannot be patented. And if you make a very nice presentation, if you make symbols, diagrams in a very nice manner, again, those things cannot be patented because they are just things. So presentation of information cannot be patented. Circuit layout. So you must have seen laptops and mobile phones. They have a very complicated motherboard kind of a thing with a lot of yellow color wires going here and there. Okay. So those circuit layouts, they cannot be, the topography of integrated circuits cannot be patented. Traditional knowledge. So if your grandma or grandma knew something about some herbal medicines or something, okay, you will not be able to patent that. So if you, it's already known that haldi and neem are used for wounds, so you will not be able to patent these things. Okay. So an invention which is in effect is traditional knowledge or an aggregation or duplication of known properties is not patentable. However, if you make a combination which has got higher efficacy, good synergy, and good synergistic activities, you can still go and patent a combination of herbal medicines. Section 4 tells you that any work which is done related to atomic energy, that could be a threat to the Indian security. Okay, and therefore, any work on uranium, beryllium, thorium, or these kind of works cannot be patented under Section 4. Now, when you must have studied all this different Section 3 and 4, so there are two things that come into light. There is one is called as conditional exceptions, and other one is called as absolute exceptions. So conditional exceptions are those exceptions which can be overcome somehow or the other. So by formatting, formulating or drafting the patent in a proper way, using proper language, giving a proper description and other things, you will be able to overcome these conditional exceptions. Okay. So new form of a known substance. Okay. The mere use of a known process and mere admixture. Okay. So these are the clauses which can be somehow or the other, you can try to manage it. Okay. So if you say that you have a new salt, if you say you have a new known process, a new process, or if you say it's a mixture or an admixture, you can still overcome these objections. Okay. However, if you say that it's a new use or you use the word treatment, these are two absolute exceptions and you just cannot overcome them. So if you try to file a patent saying that I have found a new use, sorry, you will not be granting a patent. And if you mistakenly use the word treatment in your application word, again, you will not be granting a patent. So you will have to revise the term treatment or change the term treatment to say lowering of blood pressure or lowering sodium potassium levels in the body, whatever it is to do it. Okay. Now, this is a snapshot of what I just told you. So 21J is basically deals with technical advancement. Okay. So it defines invention. Okay. So, these are the things like if 21J, there's an objection in 21J, and if the patent agent, patent examiner says that you don't have a technical advance, you don't have economic significance, and that this particular thing is known to a person skilled in the art, then you can justify that there is no prior art related to it, and that there's some literature which is guiding you away from the particular thing. Section 3D, if you say that you have a new form, a new use or a known process, okay, and if these are the objections, what you need to do is you need to elaborate that it is not an, it is an admixture and that it has got synergistic activity. So if you are putting these points, you will be able to overcome these this objection of the patent examiner. And if you get an objection under that your formulation is an admixture and that is for a treatment, so either you can divert them towards 21J and say that it is not in the prior art. And for treatment, you need to reword the claim and remove the word treatment. Okay. Now stages from filing to grant of a patent. If you just look at it, this is the flow chart, which says that there's a provisional or a priority application. Okay. And the period is 12 months basically. So the day you file your application, be it a provisional application or complete application, your time starts from that particular day. That's the number one thing. Okay. However, if you file a provisional application, you will get 12 months for filing the complete application. Okay. Now from the first date of filing, whatever it is, okay, from that date till 18 months, your application will be kept secret. No one will be allowed to look at it and it will not be published by the patent office. Okay. And this will be published after 18 months. However, if you want that your publication is public, your patent is published earlier, you can apply for something which is called as early publication. There's a cost for it. And your publication in that case will be published within 1 month. Okay, so it's published within 1 month, and then you can start showing it to the world that, okay, look, this is the work that I have done, this is the patent that I have done, and I want to sell it to you, or I want to collaborate further for you, whatever it is. Okay, so that is called as publication of application. Then once you file it, there's an option of a pre-grant opposition. There's someone might come to, everyone will come to know that your patent has been filed and this is the work that you have done. And if it is the same work that they are also doing, they might like to go for a opposition. So once your patent is published, you go for an you file for a request for examination. Now, request for examination is not automatic in India. And what you need to do is you get a period of 4 years or 48 months from the first date of provisional application or complete application to file a request for examination. So once you file this request, the patent office will find out your application. They will dig out your application and they will give it to an examiner, a government employee. So he will look at your application and see whether it is being, likely to be granted or not. So you are most likely to get a report from this person within 6 months. Sometimes it can be a little more also, saying that these are the problems under various sections of section 3, 4 or 2J that your patent is not up to the mark. So this, when you get this FER report, the FER report will be very, in a very legal kind of a language. And if you're reading it for the first time, you will think that it is not very easy to file a patent or anything. It's very difficult. I think I will not be able to go through this. But if you read carefully and you study the examples that they have given, you will be able to find some difference between your invention and the invention of the earlier prior art. Okay. And then you need to prepare a reply for it. So you get 6 months for replying to this thing after the from the date of this reporting. Okay. So place the application in. So once you are done this, you that is called as placing the application in order for grant. So it will be time for decision. So either they will be saying a yes or a no. So if it is a yes, it will be granted. Okay. And if it is a no, then the no does not come just like that. They say no and they let you go. They give you a chance for hearing. So hearing is either face to face in the patent office. And nowadays it's more on Skype and online medium. So you have option for hearing. So even after hearing, if you're not able to convince the patent office that this is what it is, then it will be rejected. The steps for obtaining a patent, this is a website, ipindia.nic.in. So people can note it. They can take a screenshot of this. Basic things that we need to do. Examination, then credit examination. Yes, if you are a lady or if you are a startup, you are a startup, you can file for a expedited examination. And then these are the things. So once it is granted, you get a certificate. So usually the law says 7 days, but because of technology, you get it mostly on the same day. However, if you're using a biological material, so biological material could be a plant, herb, or it could be a organism. So if you're using a herbal plant or thing in your invention, you're making a herbal formulation or using an extract of a herbal plant, then you need to follow the guidelines of Biological Diversity Act 2002. And if you are using microorganisms, you will have to deposit the microorganism in MTCC Chandigarh. Now, towards the end of the thing, I will take you to a very quick quiz with my audience. So I see that a lot of people, more people have joined into it. Okay. So let me have an answer for this question. Patent gives you the right to make or sell a product or a process. Do you think it is a true thing or it's wrong? Is it correct or wrong? So audience, can I have answer from everyone? Yes or no? Just you have to type yes or no. So Nishant, Fatima says yes. Shahida says yes. Good. So Sonam also is saying yes. Sonal, Rahul, yes. Okay. So let me tell you the answer for this. Sandeep is also saying yes. So the answer, however, unfortunately, answer is no. Because patent gives you the right to make and sell the product. It's not true. It basically gives you the right to stop others from making the product. So in the one of the presentations back down, I told you that you don't get the right for it. You get the right only to stop others from making and selling your particular invention. Now, why is it so? Government gives you certain rights, okay? And rights cannot be taken away from you. So now suppose if I make a pen and government gives me a right that you are the person whom I have given the right to make this pen. Okay. Now I will say that since government has given me the right to make this pen, I am making and selling it. And okay, fine. So this right can be given to someone else also. So if there's a pen with a different design or a different technology, so other person will also have this design to make his own kind of a pen. Be a conflict of interest. Okay. So however, if the government gives me a right that you can stop others from making a pen of your type, that is a more easy and a more enforceable kind of a right that the government is giving me. Okay. That's the thing. Patent term is for 20 years from the date of grant. Can I have a yes or no from the people, from the audience? Patent term is for 20 years from date of grant. So just remember that the question says date of grant. Okay. So you have to tell me whether the period of 20 years is from date of grant or not. So Anuradha says yes, Sandeep yes, Nishant yes. Okay. So I'm again having a lot of yes says. Abdul, Sonal, Darshana, Rahul, Indra, Dr. Rawat, unfortunately, I'm very, I don't want to say that, but the answer is no, because the term for 20 years is not from the day of grant. The 20-year term starts from the day of filing. So suppose you go to a patent office or you do an online filing and you do a filing on, say, today, the 8th of June, okay? And then the 20 years will start from 2020 itself. So you don't need to wait till the day you will be getting a grant of the patent to start transferring your technology or talking to your collaborators, you know, for selling your patent or working on it. The day you file the patent, you get the right on the patent. Okay. However, from the date of publication, you get the right to pull the other person into the court of law. So aapke paas rights to usi din se aa jaate hain, you get the rights from the day you file the patent. But if you want to sue someone for using your invention, you have to wait till your patent is published. And as I told you earlier, publication happens at 18 months free of cost. However, by paying a small amount, you can get it published in a month also. So that is after 1 month. Now, this would be an easy one. I have elaborated it very broadly in the presentation. So patent gives worldwide protection, yes or no? So this time I believe more of the audience would be having correct answers. So I'm receiving yes and no. Deepak, he has it. Sajida says yes, Rahul Mittal says yes. Sonal says no, good. Anyone else? Sandeep, no. Okay, good. Abdul Khalid says no. So yes, the answer is very much right. The answer is no, basically. Anuradha, thank you. So patent is a territorial right. Each country has its own laws. Okay. So basically, everyone has got his own laws. So you don't want a US, because US has given a patent to some particular thing, it will not be effective in India. Similarly, India, if it gives a patent, it will not be effective in US. So for each country, you need to go and file your own patent, and then you need to have your own laws and everything. Okay, fine. So patent application should be made when the product is ready. Yes or no? So you made a make a patent application only when the product is ready. Yes or no? So I'm having almost 100% no's. Yes, it's very much true. Namrata Jadhav, no. Dashan Gugate, no. Okay, fine. So the answer is no, and congratulations to everyone for the correct answer. Because if you delay the filing, there might be a risk that someone else who is working on the invention might file a patent application before you do. And there's also a risk that if you're working on a patent or something, a publication regarding the same may come out and that will destroy the novelty of your work. So it is better to file a patent application as soon as you are ready to file it. Now, this is a very common question and very much useful for the audience. Patent application can be made after publication of the work. So you are an author of a publication, author or a co-author of a publication, and your team did a work on it and you published it. Okay. So you were not aware that you need to file it before publication or whatever it is. And now someone tells you that, this is a very good work. Why don't you go and file a patent for it? So let me know if you can file a patent for your work. No, it's only for your work after you have published the work. So can I have a yes or no? So a lot of people are saying no, that they can't publish it. Sajid is saying yes. So we have a lot of no's. Okay. So the answer is yes in this case. Okay. And the explanation is that the Patent Act gives you a grace period of 12 months. So there are not many people who are aware of this particular clause that the Patent Act gives a grace period of 12 months for filing a patent application, even if you have published your work. It's not for someone else's work, but if it's your own work and you publish it, you have the right to go and patent it. So they might ask that all the authors and co-authors who are in the paper, the same authors and co-authors are also there in the patent. Okay, so that might be a requirement, but otherwise they give you a period of grace of 12 months. Every invention is patentable. Do you think anything can be patented? Yes or no? Good. Dr. Rawat says yes, Sonal says no, and Radha says no, Sajid says yes. Good. So it's a mixture of yes and no. So one yes and one no. Very good. So just as I told you, every invention is not patentable. Why? Because we elaborated on Section 3 and Section 4, which says that a few of the inventions under Section 3 and 4 are not patentable. So if you're making a device for baking the house, or just making a ether or ester salt of a particular drug, it will not be patentable. Or any work on atomic energy will not be patentable. So not all inventions are patentable. And how do you know if your work is innovative or not? Okay, so I'm probably exceeding a little bit of time. Is it okay, sir?
Yes, sir.
So if you have two inventions, say you made an invention with say A, B, C, D. So you combine four particular components, say you combine four herbal drugs and you made a product. And now there is someone else who says that I made a product with three components. Okay. So in this particular case, since he has used less number of products and he's giving the same effect at a lower cost, okay, it's a technical advancement and it's an economic advantage. And therefore, this person will be able to patent his work. Okay. And he will also not be infringing your work. Okay, so this is one of the possibilities. The second thing is that if you are having a patent with four things, A, B, C, and D, and there's a other person who's adding a fifth component to it, okay, a fifth hub into it, and he wants to patent this particular thing, he will not be able to patent it. Okay, so if you're adding something extra to it, no, But if you're reducing that thing, yes, you will be able to patent it. And one of the questions that the audience always wants to know is the patent agent required to file a patent? Okay. So as per law, the patent agent is not at all required to file a patent. Okay. However, you see that a patent agent is someone who is well-versed in the legal matters, and you are someone who is versed very good in the technical matters. So it's basically a patent is a techno-legal document, and it requires the expertise of both a patent person who knows the patent and a technical person, that is you. So only a good combination of this kind is the most fruitful thing. Okay. And patent agents, I always tell that a relation between a patent agent and an inventor is like a doctor and a patient. So if the patient does not go and tell everything to the doctor very frankly and very clearly, the doctor will not be able to give a good treatment to him. Similarly, for a good patent to be drafted, it is necessary that the people go and tell what kind of a patent they have, work they have. And for this, you can sign NDA agreements and other things are there. And this is the brief thing about the fees that you want to know if you are filing a patent. So this is kind of fees that comes up. Okay. So an ordinary application will cost you just 1600 rupees. And there are other fees. So you can take a screenshot of it. And then this is the website, which is called as legistin.com. And if you just put in your parameters over there, like I will show you over here. And this is the scale, like you need to decide how complicated your invention is. Okay. And then you just need to describe your invention in a few words, like transdermal delivery system for exceptionally prolonged release. So you don't need to tell your whole invention. And then there is a drop down. So there is a drop down which is called as human necessities. So anything which is useful for humans, be it medicines, drugs, or many other things which are used for humans, come under this category. So you need to choose a category over here. And then since you are an individual, so you can say you are an individual. And then if you have complex drawings, so when you say complex drawing, it means more of mechanical, complicated mechanical drawings, not the simple FTIR scans or dissolution data graphs that you have. So here you mention 000 everywhere. And if you have plants in it, you can mention one plant, two plants, three plants, how many plants you have used. And if you're not used anything, you can just leave it blank. And then you can choose an option. If you want early publication, you can say yes. If you don't want, you can say no. And once you submit it by telling your name and other things, so you will get a thank you response and you will get a quote for it, basically. Okay. So once you get this quote, you can we can further discuss about how to file the patent and what best we can do to negotiate the prices and all. So Legistin is basically a consortium. So they do a lot of work. And currently, they offer around 50% discount on the fees that you receive through this quotation mark. So if you received X amount, they will do it at half the price. So that fees will include everything, including your government filing cost and everything. Okay. And for anything, any advice or anything, if you want to reach me out, my phone number and email ID is this. And if you are lazy enough to type it all, so technology has advanced, you can just scan this QR code using your Paytm or any other application, and you can just scan and add to the contact, and my contacts will be saved in your phone. So you can contact me anytime, anywhere you want for anything. Okay. There's nothing. Since it is my passion to help everyone bring their innovation and invention in the forefront in the form of patents, your questions won't be troubling to me, and will be more than happy to help you in any possible way that I can do it. Thank you very much, audience. So those interested, they can take a screenshot of this particular slide.
Hello.
Thank you very much, sir, for your guidance.
Hello.
Thank you.
Hello.
Is there any question from audience?
Yes.
Is there
Hello.
Any question from audience?
Yes. Yes. Hello.
Yes, Hello. Sir. Please ask.
Very nice presentation. Sir, can we take a patent of analytical method development of herbal marker compound by HPLC or HPTLC method?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay.
There are a lot of patents on analytical methods of all kinds. You can take a patent for that.
Okay, okay, sir. Thank you, thank you.
Sir, I have a question. It was said in the presentation that addition of an extra component to a patented formula will not let you have a patent.
Yes, sir.
But if that extra component is improving the quality and adding benefits, will it be patentable?
Yes, it will be patentable if it is showing a higher efficacy and synergistic activity. So if these factors are met,